Good morning.
What is the most innovative company in the world? Any guesses? Apple, Google, Facebook. There are a lot of innovative companies all around the world, including here in Asia. But there are more of them in Silicon Valley, arguably, than anywhere else. The companies we just ticked off, Google, Apple, Facebook, Twitter, HP. In a small little part of Northern California, there are hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of these world-changing technology companies that are changing the way all of us send email, WhatsApp with our friends, share photos, and run our businesses. And it causes a lot of people around the world to wonder, what is it about Silicon Valley that makes it such a dynamic ecosystem? What is it about that culture that enables so much innovation to flourish? And there are all sorts of theories about this question, right? There are people who say, well, it's the delicious food that's served in these company campuses. And having spent many years in Silicon Valley and working at some of these companies and helping start some of these companies, I can attest that the food is very delicious at these campuses. Some people say it's actually about the special nap pods that exist on the campus. So if you get sleepy in the afternoon at the Google campus, you can go into one of these little nap pods and take a 30-minute nap in the middle of the workday. A very enticing perk. Or maybe it's the great universities that are nearby that enable smart people to come together and innovate. But to attribute the success of Silicon Valley and the success of Apple and Google and WhatsApp and Facebook, to attribute the success of all of these companies that we know of and admire to the food or the nap pods is like saying that a fast red Ferrari car is powerful because of its red paint job, right? It's just the surface. When you really dig into what's going on at these companies, you realize that the magic of Silicon Valley is a magical solution that we probably already know, which is that it's about the people. It's people who come together every single day, work together, and develop the idea for the iPhone. It's people who come together around a conference room table, brainstorm a new solution to a problem, and come up with the innovation of the Tesla electric car, or whatever innovation that matters to you. All of these companies are ultimately just consist of amazing individual people like you and me. So to understand any amazing business anywhere in the world, I think you have to start your analysis by understanding how does this company attract, manage, and retain amazingly creative individuals. To begin your analysis any other way misses the point. So if you want to understand what makes Apple so amazing, ask the question, what kind of people does Apple attract into the company, and how do those people work together? And what can all of us learn from how those people come together and produce amazing innovation? So how do amazingly innovative companies recruit, manage, and retain entrepreneurial people? And today, I want to focus our time together on this particular type of employee, entrepreneurial employees, people who are creative, people who take risks, people who are bold, people who are original and agile and flexible, people who are entrepreneurial. These are the sorts of employees that populate Silicon Valley. These are the sorts of employees that are all around the world, inside of our organizations, in our schools, in our teams. And these are the sorts of people that can actually produce the products and services that change the world. And I want to talk about sort of two elements related to the question of entrepreneurial people. The first is how all of us can become more entrepreneurial ourselves inside of our own companies, our own institutions, and produce the kind of innovation that may make us the next innovator of the next iPhone. And then I want to talk about how all of us as leaders, as CEOs, as executives, as managers, how can we attract these sorts of entrepreneurial people onto our teams? And this topic is very personal to me. I'm extremely passionate about this word in particular. And I feel like I've been passionate about entrepreneurship and entrepreneurial ideas since before I could even spell the word in English, entrepreneur, because it's kind of a hard word to spell sometimes. I've been passionate about this idea for almost my entire life. And I want to share with you a bit about my personal journey to be on stage with you here this morning. So I grew up in California, and in the sixth grade, I took a class at school that was taught by a computer teacher, and the class was about how to fix and repair Macintosh computers. So the school taught this class to educate all the students on how to fix computers, and then when the school's computers would break down, they'd deploy us as the free labor force to go repair all the school equipment. So it was a good deal for the school. But we had a really brilliant teacher at this class, and but like a lot of IT teachers, he was a bit strange. Okay, so he, for one, denied that he had a real name. So he made us address him as Mac Doctor. And it was only upon graduating from the class that he would tell us his real legal name, which was Ken. But we knew him as Mac Doctor. Okay. And one day the Mac Doctor showed up to school on a regular school day, and he had shaved half of his head and half of his face. So if you can imagine a full head of hair and drawing a line down the middle and all shaved, and then a full beard, one side of his face completely shaved, a full beard on the other side. And that's just how he lived. He was a very kooky guy. And in the spirit of this kookiness, the Mac Doctor announced that we would have a final exam, but that the final exam of the class would have nothing to do with the material we had studied in school. All we would have to do to get an A+ on the final exam would be to memorize a poem. And if we could recite back to him a poem, he would give us an A+ in the class. So the day before the final exam, my classmates and I, we're in the sixth grade, we're about 12 years old, we gather in the classroom, and he distributes this poem. But in a sort of classic American moment, it turns out not to be a poem of literature, but rather the text of a corporate advertisement that ran in the late 1980s, early 1990s. And this advertisement was called Think Different, run by Apple Computers. Anyone seen the Think Different ad before? Okay, so the first takeaway for today is to go on YouTube after the talk and look up Think Different advertisement. It's one of the most iconic advertisements ever created. And Apple ran this ad on TV. And we were forced to memorize the text of this ad. And ever since having memorized it, I haven't forgotten it. So I thought it'd be fun to kick off our day today, since we're talking about thinking big, we're talking about leadership energy. I'm gonna share with you how this advertisement goes right now, okay? So it goes like this. Here's to the crazy ones, the misfits, the rebels, the round pegs and the square holes, the ones who see things differently. They're not fond of rules, and they have no respect for the status quo. You can disagree with them, you can glorify or vilify them, but about the only thing you can't do is ignore them, because they change things. They push the human race forward. And while some may see them as the crazy ones, we see genius, because the people who are crazy enough to think that they can change the world are the ones who do. Now, if you can imagine a lineup of 12-year-olds reciting that one after the other, you might conclude that it does some sort of psychological damage to the kids. I'd like to think that for me and some of my friends, it proved inspiring. We are inspired to try to live out that message, to embody that message, and to think differently about our own lives and the world around us. And after the class, I went up to the Mac doctor and I asked him a practical question. I said, how do you go about changing the world? You know, just like any specific tips or tricks for how to do that? And he said, one of the best ways to change the world, Ben, is to be an entrepreneur. As we just heard on stage, entrepreneurs identify problems in the world, and instead of just complaining about their problems, which so many people do, they actually try to develop a solution. So he told me, Ben, if you want to think differently and change the world, the next time you experience a problem, don't just complain about it. See if you can develop a solution to that problem and charge money to others for delivering that solution. And so that class and that teacher and that experience of memorizing this advertisement set me on a journey of entrepreneurship, of creating companies and being part of the sort of Silicon Valley gold rush era of creating internet companies. And I loved being an entrepreneur. I loved trying to participate in this innovation ecosystem that we talked about. At some point, I grew a little restless, and I realized that I had spent my entire life in the United States, and I wanted to see the world. And so we hired a CEO to come in and run one of the companies that I had founded, and I took some time off from school and traveled around the world. I was writing a blog at the time, and I had written a book. So I posted a message online, and I said, if anyone wants to host me in their home, I'll gladly take a couch or a bed in exchange for a potentially interesting conversation. And so people wrote in, and I left the States for the first time, and I visited with people in India, in China, in Italy, in Brazil, staying in the homes of people who felt like they knew me, and I learned about their culture. I learned about the way they thought about business and their life. And I had kind of a profound realization. Here I was, a young man from California who thought that entrepreneurship meant starting an internet company in Silicon Valley. And yet as I traveled around, including here in Asia, I have so many memories of China and India and Japan and Indonesia, meeting with people who were not starting tech companies in Silicon Valley, but in the way they were thinking, they reminded me of the best tech entrepreneurs I had met. In the way that they were solving problems, they struck me as utterly entrepreneurial. In the way that they were adapting their lives, I realized that they were as much an entrepreneur as me. And I realized that perhaps entrepreneurship is more than just a business idea. Perhaps it's more than just an idea that relates to people who start companies. Maybe it's a life idea. Maybe it's a global idea. And so I returned home and started writing about these ideas. And along the way, I had breakfast with my co-author now, Reid Hoffman, and I was telling him about my travels. And I was telling him about my realization that entrepreneurship and entrepreneurial skills seem to be possessed by lots of people all around the world who are not necessarily starting their own companies. They're doctors, they're lawyers, they're teachers, they're professors, they're students, they're middle managers, but they're entrepreneurs. And I told this to Reid, and he kind of laughed at me. And he said, well, you know, Ben, that's why I started LinkedIn, to be the technology platform on which every individual professional can take control of their life and manage themselves as if they were the CEO of their own life. He said, I started LinkedIn in my living room in Mountain View, California, to be the technology platform on which every individual professional could grapple with the reality that they may be an employee at someone else's company, they may be an employee for the government, but they're always going to be the CEO of their own life. They're always going to be the CEO of their own career. And so this shared passion and shared realization caused us to team up and write our first book together, which is called The Startup of You. And we argue that the most successful professionals today, the people who are leading the most fulfilling careers, no matter the kind of work they're doing, do so because they bring to bear the same skills and the same mindset that entrepreneurs do when starting companies. We argue that everyone needs to embrace the startup that is themselves and think like an entrepreneur, no matter the work they're doing. I'm curious, just to take a quick poll of you right now, when I say go, I want you to show me with your fingers, okay, on a scale of 1 to 10, how entrepreneurial do you consider yourself right now in your current work? So hold up 10 fingers if you think of yourself as more dynamic and creative and flexible than Steve Jobs was. And hold up one finger if you can't solve a creative problem to save your life. Think about it for a second. Go. How entrepreneurial are we in this audience? Some eights, some sevens, some fives, sixes. Okay, you can put your hands down. I saw almost no tens, which means we're all on the same page that we can all get better, and we can all improve, right? We can all become even more entrepreneurial, more creative, more innovative. And what I want to talk about now is a few of the specific strategies or frameworks for how we can all become more entrepreneurial in our own lives. And then again, I want to shift from the perspective of the leaders in the room, the managers, the CEOs, the corporate executives, and talk about how we can get people who think this way into our organizations. First, another polling question. Amazon, I don't think, has a huge business in Malaysia, but it is a huge business. And I'm curious if any of you know how old Amazon is. Pop quiz. Anyone know how old this company is? It's this, you know, juggernaut of an e-commerce company based in Seattle. Amazon, 10 years, 20 years, 21 years, okay? Amazon's 21 years old, which is kind of amazing to think about because that it's that old. But it's been around for 21 years. Legally speaking, it's been around 21 years. But if you ask Amazon's founder, if you ask the entrepreneur who started Amazon, how old is your company, what does he say? He doesn't say 21 years. He says at Amazon.com, it's always day one. We are 1 day old. The day you asked me that question, we're 1 day old. In fact, Jeff Bezos, who's the founder of Amazon, writes an annual shareholder letter to his investors every year. And he ends the letter the same way every single time. Every year, the letter ends the exact same way. He says at Amazon.com, it's always day one. No matter the successes or failures we've had in the year prior, it's always day one. And that mentality speaks to the fundamental philosophy of the startup of you, and we'd argue the fundamental philosophy of entrepreneurial thinking. And it's the fundamental philosophy that we think every one of us in the room today needs to adopt if we wish to have 10 fingers on our hands for how entrepreneurial we think we are. And that is the idea that we are continually improving. Continually improving. It's always day one. It's always a fresh start. You see this mentality embodied by lots of the most successful entrepreneurs. Who here uses Gmail as an email provider? Okay, so a lot of us, 3/4 of us. Was anyone by chance using Gmail back in the day when it launched with the big report bug link on the top and the little beta logo under Gmail? See the little beta word under Gmail? So back in the day, Google launched Gmail as a fully functioning email product, but kept the beta label under the logo and had a big link that said report bug. And people were very confused. I said, wait, does this product work or does it not work? Because normally when we think of the word beta in software, it means products that have bugs, products that are not ready for mainstream use. And Larry Page, the CEO of Google, had to issue a statement and say, hey, the product works, it's secure, it's stable, but we're going to keep it in beta for a long time to remind ourselves that a product is never finished. That the moment we declare our product finished is the moment a competitor surpasses us. So we're going to keep it in beta. And this generated a whole trend in Silicon Valley and in the tech industry in general, in which lots of entrepreneurs shipped products and kept the product in beta. For years, it's in beta. It works, but we're always trying to improve it. So for entrepreneurs, the word finished is its own F word, you might say in English. You never want to declare something finished. Most importantly, you never want to declare yourself finished. And this is the philosophy of the startup of you. None of us can be finished products. We call this idea permanent beta. The most entrepreneurial organizations in the world are in permanent beta. The most entrepreneurial professionals in the world, all of us, we need to be in permanent beta. And this can actually be part of your identity. I once gave a talk to a room full of people, and they had a surprise for me when I walked in the room. They were all wearing a shirt, all wearing different shirts. When I got on stage, they all ripped off their shirt, and underneath it, they had another shirt that said, I am in permanent beta. The whole audience, I am in permanent beta. It can almost be part of a mantra that we repeat to ourselves to remind ourselves that we have bugs, we have problems, we have flaws, but we can get better. Permanent beta, permanent weird, permanent growth as human beings, growth as organizations. So I'm curious, I'm going to call on someone in the audience, and I want you to tell me how many years of experience you have in your industry. So if you're going for a job interview tomorrow and someone said, how many years of experience do you have doing your job, what would you say? So I'm going to call on someone in the front row. How about you, ma'am, right here? How many years of experience do you have doing whatever you're doing? 10 years of experience. Okay. And how about you, sir? How many years of experience do you have? 10 years as well. Okay, so 10 years of experience. All right, so many of us, a lot of successful people in the room today, a lot of people who have a lot of years of experience doing your work. But here's a different question to ask yourself. How many growth years have you experienced at work? Because, you know, a lot of people on their resume, on their LinkedIn profile, they say, I have, you know, 13 years of marketing experience, say. But in fact, that's not true. As a friend of mine likes to say, really they have 1 year of marketing experience repeated 13 times. Most of us are not in permanent beta. Most of us are not actually growing every single day. Because growth is hard. Growth can be painful. Growth can be stressful. The path of least resistance is to keep doing the same thing we've always been doing. Some of us, of course, are forced into jobs that require some growth. This is Barack Obama 2008, Barack Obama 2015. Like him or hate him, he's had to grow. But most of us are not in such jobs. For most of us, we have to make a conscious choice to embrace the idea of permanent beta. So if you remember one thing about the entrepreneurial cast of mind, remember this phrase and remember this idea, and see if you can every day, every week, every month, every year, think about the ways you've grown. And I want to leave you with a specific sort of tactical tip that I find useful when thinking about permanent beta. So the next time someone asks you, do you have a certain skill? Have you had a certain type of experience? If you haven't had the experience or you do not possess the skill, just add the word yet to the end of your sentence in response. Okay, so someone may say, hey, Do you have any experience programming websites using WordPress? Normally you might say, no, I don't have any experience doing that. With the entrepreneurial framework, if you embrace permanent beta, you say, no, I don't have any experience programming with WordPress yet. Someone asks you, have you spent any time in Western Europe? How familiar are you with the Western European economies? I haven't been to Western Europe yet. It's a single word, it's a short word, but it's an incredibly powerful way to remind yourself and the world that you're still growing. You're still in permanent beta. So that's the mindset of the entrepreneur. That's the mindset of every great for-profit entrepreneur, social entrepreneur, nonprofit entrepreneur in Silicon Valley and around the world. We think this is the single most important thing that unites how all entrepreneurs think. Now, there's a set of other strategies, which I won't get into today, around how entrepreneurs behave, around how they adapt their companies, how they build networks, how they take intelligent risk. There are lots of things that we can learn from how entrepreneurs build amazing businesses and apply those skills to our own lives. But I just today want to just talk about the mindset issue, because that's the most important. If you're not thinking the right way, none of the other skills will really manifest or sustain themselves over the long term. Okay, so we opened our presentation this morning asking ourselves, what do the most innovative companies in the world have in common? And the answer was quite simple. It was one word. It was people. I then shared a little bit about my own story of becoming an entrepreneur, but also realizing that the entrepreneurial mindset, the startup of you mindset, was global and was broader, and it was something that we can all benefit from. And the linkage between those two ideas is that for all of us who are starting our own companies, for all of us who are managing people inside companies, if we want to become more innovative as an organization, we need to attract people who are in permanent beta. We need to attract people who are growing, and we need to support their entrepreneurial instincts. But we need to do actually a lot more than that. If we want to build an innovative business, if we want to have more innovation inside of our organization, we need to rethink our entire way of relating to our employees. If we want to have a decent shot at attracting people who will build the next Gmail, who will build the next iPhone, who will build the next Tesla car, or just produce an incremental innovation on our team, if we want to have any shot at attracting those sorts of employees and managing effectively those sorts of employees, we need to rethink how we relate to talent. And we need to first do that by understanding how our relationship with our employees has changed. And it's changed dramatically over the last 40 or 50 years. So for many decades, companies operated like families. We've all probably heard CEOs, managers, maybe even ourselves say, my company is a family. It's a lovely idea, but it ain't true. Because if you're a manager or you're a CEO and you have the ability to fire an employee, guess what? It's not a family. Because last time I checked, I couldn't get fired from my family, no matter how much I might annoy my brother. This is actually a photo of my family from back in the day. I'll let you guess which one I am. Not my father with the flawless mustache, but one of the other three. And it would have been unthinkable as a child for me to have sat down at the dinner table with my family and for my father to have said to me, you know, Ben, we're sorry, but there's just not room for you in the Casnochas anymore. Your table setting skills are doing nothing for our bottom line. And your interest in baseball just isn't advancing our family priorities. So we're going to have to let you go, but hey, don't take it personally. It's just family. So So our companies aren't really families anymore. They used to be. In 1963, an executive at General Electric said that employee job security was a prime company objective. Right? Can you imagine a CEO today saying employee job security is a prime company objective? But for many decades, companies really were set up and could afford to basically guarantee employment to their employees in exchange for a guarantee of loyalty from their employees in return. Right? So the compact at work was, we guarantee you a job, you guarantee you'll be loyal to us. But as globalization has come, as the technology revolution has transformed our economies, all of us who are managers and leaders in business know that we can no longer afford to make those sorts of guarantees, right? If we want to adapt our business, if we want to be innovative, we have to continually retool our talent base to have employees who have the latest and greatest skills, right? You can't just guarantee a 23-year-old a job for the next 40 years. The companies always have to be adapting if they wish to stay alive in today's economy. So companies can no longer afford to treat employees like family. And either way, millennial employees and younger employees have no interest in spending their entire life at one employer, right? For those of you under age 35, think about whether you would want to spend the entirety of your life at a single company like my grandparents did and so many folks from previous generations did. It was totally normal, but no longer, right? Our interests have changed. The definition of a modern career has changed. So if our companies aren't families, that represents a pretty significant shift from how we've always thought about organizational development and leadership. If you're not leading a family, what are you leading? Well, a lot of CEOs struggle with this question, and they decide to embrace the opposite of a family member. And they treat their employees like free agents. They treat their employees like short-term mercenaries. They say, I'm not going to guarantee you a job, and you're not being loyal to me, so guess what? You're on effectively a one-day contract. And I don't make up that phrase. At GE alone, you see this transformation. In 1963, employee job security is a prime company objective. Fast forward to 1995, the CEO of GE, Jack Welch, says, oh, no. At GE, we have one-day contracts. You prove yourself every single day, or you're out of a job. And later, Welch says in an interview, if you want loyalty, get a pet. Don't expect loyalty from us. But do you think you'd do your best work in a culture or at a company if you were worried that you're going to get fired every single day? Or as a leader, do you think you could pursue real innovation if you were worried your employees might leave any day? So this free agent approach, while offering flexibility, doesn't actually allow us to build the sort of relationships that will enable innovation. Treating your employees like free agents is not what will let you attract the next great engineer, the next great innovator who can produce change for your business. So for the last few years, after Reed and I wrote The Startup of You, we were really focused on this question because we heard from executives all around the world, how do I attract Startup of You style employees? How do I cultivate the permanent beta mentality inside of our organization? And our answer was, you have to attract people who themselves are entrepreneurial. And you need to do that by stop treating them like family members, which they never were. Also stop treating them like free agents. And start treating them as allies. Carve a middle path and relate to your employees as allies. And over the last few years, we've developed this management framework called the Alliance as a framework for managers and leaders to forge a new, more realistic relationship with their entrepreneurial employees, with their employees who are creative, who are bold, who are thinking differently. And in an alliance, I want to encourage all the managers and leaders in the room to look at your employees, have a one-on-one meeting with your employee, and say, wow, Mr. and Miss Employee, you're going to have a long, diverse career that likely will involve working at companies that are not ours. You will probably work at many different companies in your life, maybe even many different industries. So what you need more than anything else is adaptability in your career. and we need adaptability as an organization. So let's forge an alliance and invest in each other so we can both be adaptive. Your career, our company. In other words, as a manager, as a leader, you want to look at your employees and say, by the end of your having worked at our company, your LinkedIn profile will be more impressive than it is right now. For the leaders in the room, think about whether you can actually deliver on that value proposition to your employees. Will their LinkedIn profiles or their resumes be more impressive by the end of having worked at your company? But that's the promise you need to make to them. You can't guarantee lifetime employment. You can make sure they have lifetime employability over the course of a very long and competitive career. In exchange, you're asking from them a commitment to stick around and do great work at your organization. Stick around for a meaningful period of time and invest in the company. Not to leave the moment a better opportunity comes, but to stick around and invest in the company. If you treat your employees as allies, we think this is the best way to have a shot at attracting and managing the next generation of employees. And we've now traveled around the world and worked with thousands, tens of thousands of managers, CEOs of the most innovative companies in the world. And the most innovative companies realize that the way you attract great people, the way you manage, is not through delicious food in the cafeteria. It's not through nap pods. It's not through fancy parking lots. It's through a different sort of employee value proposition that promises career transformation for the employees. If you are a permanent beta employee, if you are in permanent beta, you want growth. You want to keep growing, and you want an employer who will help you grow. Now, at the heart of the alliance is building a real relationship with your employees. And I'm fascinated by how quickly we forget in business how to build relationships with people. We're pretty good at building relationships in our romantic lives and our friendship lives, are we not? But in business, we forget. So, you know, in friendship, it's pretty uncommon, isn't it, to meet someone for coffee for the first time and sit down with them and say, hey, I'm looking for a best friend. Like, are you interested in a best friend? Because if we like each other, maybe I can be your best friend and you can be my best friend. Or in romance, in certain cultures, in certain countries, it's uncommon to ask someone to marry you in the first 5 minutes of meeting them, right? You tend to try to get to know them a little bit before you actually enter into a marriage. So why is it in business that when we onboard a new employee onto our team, we have this bizarre day one ritual in which we say, welcome to the company family. We hope you do great work here forever. And the employees sort of thinking to themselves, that's definitely not true. But I don't know what else to say. So yeah, this is my dream job. I'm so excited to be here. And I can't wait to do great work at your company forever. Both sides know they just had a dishonest conversation. They literally just lied to each other on the first day of work. But we don't have language to talk about it any other way. If you're a smart, innovative manager who wants to attract entrepreneurial employees and you embrace the alliance idea, build a relationship with your employees, tactically speaking, using a framework we call tours of duty. Each of your best employees should be on a tour of duty at your company. What is a tour of duty? A tour of duty refers to a specific period of time over which you commit to the employee and they commit to you. A tour of duty has a mission objective that's specific for this employee. So maybe they're going to come work at your company and you want them to develop a certain service or open an office or ship a new product. It's whatever the mission objective is for this employee. Second, a tour of duty upon completion benefits the employee's career. We often forget this as leaders. We think our employees should be oh so grateful for working for us. They should be grateful for having a job. But remember, we're talking about entrepreneurial employees. We're talking about employees who have options in the labor market. We're talking about people who will make a difference at your company. They require more than just a job. They require the opportunity to transform their own life, their own career. So by working at your company, they should understand very concretely, how does this benefit my career? Third element, how does this benefit the company? We tend not to forget about that. And then finally, duration. So Eric Schmidt, the CEO of Google, told us he thinks about tours of duty at Google as, on average, 2 to 5 years. You know, a year to learn the job, a year or two to do the job, and a year or two to transition your job to your successor. The precise amount of time that a tour of duty lasts for will depend on the role. It depends on your company. But what I want to encourage you to do is to be concrete and specific about your expectation of your employees. Because the specificity lends a certain crispness to the relationship. It gives both sides clarity on the relationship. And it creates a non-awkward opportunity for you to sit down with your employee or they to sit down with you and have a career conversation. Talk about how things are going. For the managers in the room, you know that it can be sometimes a little awkward to have a career conversation with your employees, isn't it? You write an email to one of your employees, hey, just wanted to sit down and talk about your career. The employee's thinking, what did I do wrong? Am I about to be fired? It's hard to schedule these conversations. In fact, the most clicked on advertisement in LinkedIn history was an ad run by the University of Phoenix, which is a big for-profit education company, and the text of the advertisement was how to have better one-on-one conversations at work. Managers do not know how to have one-on-one conversations at work, especially how to have career conversations. So with your employees on tours of duty, you have a very structured way of checking in with your employees, asking how things are going. And if things are going well, maybe they do many tours of duty at your company. They can spend 20 years at on your team over many distinct tours of duty. Or maybe they just do a single tour of duty and then leave and join some other organization, and that's okay. They're not disloyal for leaving your organization. So tours of duty is a way to organize the relationship you have with your entrepreneurial employees. And I encourage all of you to think about the most talented person on your team today, the person that if they left, it would pain you considerably. You'd be so annoyed and disappointed and sad if they left your team. And think about whether you could have a higher quality conversation with this person if you structured their employment on a tour of duty. If you very concretely described how their career was going to be transformed as a result of having worked at your company. This is a seemingly simple conversational structure, but in our experience, we've seen so many companies able to retain star employees through organizing the conversation in this way and attract the next wave of talented entrepreneurial employees through this sort of employee value proposition. Okay, so let me recap where we've been today and then we'll open it up for questions. So we started by asking the question, what is the most innovative company in the world? And we talked about how innovative companies are able to attract innovative employees. I always find it so amazing, managers and CEOs talk about innovation until they're blue in the face, all these frameworks and strategies. If you don't have people who themselves are thinking entrepreneurially, if you don't have people who themselves are in permanent beta, how could you possibly expect your employees to conceive strategies on the job that involve risk and creativity and adaptation? So innovative companies have innovative employees. Innovative employees are employees that think like the startup of you. They embrace the entrepreneurial mindset. And that's a mindset I learned personally through the Mac Doctor and my teacher at school, and through traveling around the world in regions like this, meeting people who embodied the entrepreneurial cast of mind. And then as we, as managers and leaders coming together to talk about how to be better leaders of our organizations, as we try to attract these sorts of employees onto our team, they're the hardest people in the world to attract. Everybody wants to hire them. How do you attract these entrepreneurial employees. And I argued that you need to reimagine the employment relationship. You need to do away with lifetime employment. You need to redefine what loyalty means in the 21st century. And you want to organize employment on your team as a series of tours of duty. This is already the way Silicon Valley runs. We think this is the way lots of industries and lots of companies around the world will manage talent. So what is the most innovative company in the world? It's a company that has a genuine framework for how to attract, manage, and retain entrepreneurial talent through a framework that we call the Alliance. So thank you very much for your attention, and I'll take some questions.